Hi, I'm Corey. I'm a CPA and subject matter expert in managerial accounting. And in this video, we're going to discuss how to measure the performance of profit centers using variable and absorption income statements. We'll start off by getting an understanding of what variable and absorption costing are and discuss how to compute inventory costs under both methods. Next, we'll develop an understanding of how to prepare variable and absorption costing income statements. The ability to accurately measure a company's performance is critical for both managers and investors. So let's get started. While it's very important for companies to understand how the company is operating as a whole, many organizations are made up of individual business units called profit centers. Profit centers are departments within an organization that generate revenue and incur costs as part of doing business, therefore earning profit that is contributed to the business as a whole. In order to get insight into how profitable each business unit is, companies prepare income statements detailing the revenue, expenses, and profit of the organization. This allows them to gain insight into the organization's performance and provide them with information to make better business decisions going forward. To prepare the income statement, manufacturing companies can decide to use either variable costing or absorption costing. The main difference between the two costing approaches is how manufacturing costs are assigned to the product. Let's briefly discuss the differences between them. Absorption costing factors in all product costs as part of the cost of the product. This includes both fixed and variable costs. This costing method takes all of the manufacturing costs, including direct materials, direct labor, variable overhead, and fixed overhead, and assigns them to the cost of the product. This includes fixed overhead costs such as rent or insurance that get allocated to each product on the basis of units produced. Variable costing, on the other hand, separates out the fixed and variable overhead costs. Under this method, the fixed overhead costs that we just mentioned are treated as a period cost and are excluded from the product cost. Like the name states, variable costing only assigns the variable manufacturing costs, such as direct materials, direct labor, and variable overhead, to the product. Let's look at a brief example of how costs would get allocated to one unit of inventory under each of these methods. Let's assume the manufacturing costs for each unit produced by ABC Manufacturing Company in a period were as follows. Direct materials were $100 per unit, direct labor was $50 per unit, and variable overhead was $25 per unit. In this case, we have a $50,000 total fixed cost. To calculate the per unit fixed cost, we would take the total fixed cost and divide it by the number of units produced. In this case, let's say 2,000 units were produced, we would take the $50,000, divide it by the 2,000 units, giving us $50 per unit. So if ABC Manufacturing Company had 1,000 units in ending inventory, what would be the value of that ending inventory? Well, the first step would be to determine the per unit product cost. Let's calculate this using absorption costing first. Remember the formula from earlier is direct materials plus direct labor plus variable overhead plus fixed overhead gives us that absorption product cost. So in this case, we would take the $100 in direct materials plus the $50 in direct labor plus the $25 in variable overhead plus the $50 in fixed overhead, giving us $225 per unit. Now, remember, the value of ending inventory equals units in ending inventory times the per unit product cost. So if we multiply that by the total 1,000 units in ending inventory, that works out to $225,000 in total inventory based on this method. However, if we were to use variable costing, remember, we would calculate the per unit product cost in a similar way. However, we need to make sure not to include the fixed overhead. In this case, the per unit product cost would be the $100 in direct materials plus the $50 in direct labor plus the $25 in variable overhead, giving us $175 per unit. Ending inventory equals units in ending inventory times the per unit product cost. So if we multiply this $175 per unit times the 1,000 units in ending inventory, that works out to $175,000 in total inventory value. As you can see from this example, the unit product costs under absorption costing will always be larger than under variable costing, since it includes the fixed overhead costs. Now, it's a common mistake under variable costing to miss separating out all of the variable and fixed overhead costs. While this is not as critical for absorption costing, since fixed overhead costs such as rent or insurance are included within the product costs, under variable costing, all fixed overhead costs must be separated out from the product cost. Since that product cost is used to calculate an organization's cost of goods sold or variable product costs, whether a company is using variable or absorption costing will impact their operating income. Under absorption costing, operating income is calculated by taking sales, subtracting out the cost of goods sold, less the selling and administrative costs. Under variable costing, operating income is calculated by taking the sales, less the variable product costs, less the fixed costs. Let's go back to the example from earlier and look at the operating income that would be reported on ABC Company's income statement under both approaches. Let's assume that the company sold 500 units at $400 each this month, which works out to $200,000 of revenue for the company. Now, whether we choose to use absorption or variable costing, this revenue number will stay the same. However, we'll see a difference on the cost side. So let's see if we can calculate the total operating income using absorption costing first. Remember from earlier that we calculated the per unit absorption product cost to be $225 per unit. If we take this and multiply it by the 500 units sold, that gives us the company's cost of goods sold of $112,500. Now we can take the $200,000 in revenue, subtract out this $112,500 cost of goods sold for a gross margin of $87,500. Now let's assume they had $25,000 of selling and administrative costs, which we'll subtract out next, bringing us to a total operating income of $62,500. Let's do this again, but using the variable costing approach. Remember from earlier, we calculated the per unit variable product cost to be $175 per unit. If we multiply this by the 500 units sold, this gives us total variable product costs of about $87,500. Let's subtract that from the revenue of $200,000, giving us a contribution margin of $112,500. Here we can see the contribution margin is higher than the gross margin in the previous example, and that's because the fixed overhead costs have not been factored into the product costs. However, the next step would be to subtract out both the $20,000 fixed selling and administrative costs and all the fixed overhead costs for the period, which we mentioned earlier were $50,000. This results in a total operating income of $42,500, which is $20,000 less than the result under the absorption costing method. The main reason for this is that under the absorption costing method, the fixed overhead costs have been applied to the inventory value, and some of this inventory has not yet been sold. While under the variable costing method, all of these fixed costs have now been expensed in this period. Profit centers can be evaluated under either approach. However, under the variable costing approach, it may be more effective to evaluate a manager's performance. This is because the fixed overhead costs that they may not have as much control over are kept segregated from the product costs and therefore do not impact the gross margin of the profit center. And that brings us to the end of this video. Remember, in order for organizations to be successful in the long run, they need an effective way to measure the performance of their profit centers. Absorption and variable costing income statements give them the opportunity to dig deeper into their operating results and make better long-term business decisions. If you're interested in learning more about this topic or others, please feel free to check out our additional videos on many more related topics.